often obviously teach them to say the word so that they can get them to label the item, okay? But this teaching them to talk about things in their absence, this intraverbal, is often severely lacking in a lot of training programs for children. It's like you teach them a vocabulary, but don't teach them how to use it in any kind of meaningful way in terms of social interaction. So that's where part of our emphasis is going to be today. We're going to be talking about that, developing the intraverbal relationships, because just because you know the names of something doesn't mean we can talk about those things and use it to socially interact. Okay? So this is Skinner's analysis of verbal behavior. We call these verbal operants. We call it the manned, the tact, the echoic, and the intraverbal. Okay, it's essentially asking for something, labeling things, repeating what you hear, and talking about things in their absence is another way of looking at it. I want you to think, though, a little bit about this notion of these types of responses, the tact, or the labeling, the echoic, vocal imitation, intraverbal, being controlled by social reinforcement and its relationship to spontaneous language. I really want you to think about that. Because as we start looking at language, verbal behavior, we can teach all these different skills. But what we're also interested in is how these kids put these words together, the syntax and grammar skills, and their spontaneous use of this language. Now, I want to tell you the formal aspects of how we put things together. I want coffee, please, or I want book, please. You know, we do have ways in our culture of putting words together, and it varies from culture to culture where we put the adjectives and so forth. But the bottom line is, these are things that we call the formal aspects of grammar. And one of the things that happens in working with children with autism is oftentimes they approach that very quickly. So now the child asks for a book, and then now the teacher say, I want book, please. But they don't know what I want means. They don't know who I is. They don't know what want really means. But they'll say book because they know they get the book. And why do you put the please on the end? Well, these are kind of conventions that we use in our society to talk. And it sounds better, but functionally it's no better than going book and getting a book. Okay? Now we do want to teach those other aspects. Now, like we want to neglect them. But again, I don't want a child running around, I want book please, when they can't ask for, I want to be picked up, or I want to go outside, or I want something to eat. Those are more important that we teach, perhaps eat and up and outside is maybe some other types of ways of requesting things rather than worrying about the word order and how many words we put together. Let's look at the functional use of language before we worry too much about the formal aspects. But the spontaneous verbal behavior always bothered me, because I had a lot of parents that would come up to me and they would say, well, my child knows a lot of words, but they never use them unless they want something. Okay? So they say, well, they got 200 words, but they don't use them very much. If they want something, they can ask for it. Let's go back and take a look. When you look back here at this expressive responses, well, yeah, they use it when they want something because they get what they ask for. How about all the rest of it, though? Let's say a child happens to look outside and sees a doggy and says, doggy. Okay, well, that's what we want. We've been training this child to go dog and cat and horse and shoe and, you know, cup and bowl and spoon. We've been working our tails off to try to teach them all these different skills. And now all of a sudden the child's looking out the window and they go, doggy. What happens when the child does that? What's the reinforcer? Well, sometimes what happens is people say, wow, that's right, that's a doggy, woohoo, you know, excitement, all kind of marching band comes out. What frequently happens, though, is because everybody's in a training mode, is that now all of a sudden the child sees the doggy and they go, doggy? They go, oh, you're right, it's a doggy, and what does the doggy say? And what color is a doggy? And how many legs does a doggy have? And what does the doggy eat? And where does the doggy sleep? And pretty soon, what you'll find is that instead of a marching band coming on, it's like work appears. The child's now essentially, inadvertently, people weren't aware of this, they may have actually punished the behavior that they wanted to develop, the spontaneous labeling of things. They can screw it up real easily, because instead of reinforcing the behavior, they end up turning it into a work situation. And for the child's perspective, the best thing that they can do next time when they see a dog is just keep quiet. Because if they say doggy, it's going to turn into work, okay? So we got to be careful to make sure what we're doing is really reinforcing the behaviors we want. If we want a child to spontaneously label things, we got to reinforce it when it happens and not turn it into a work situation. Doesn't mean we don't have to expand their abilities to talk about things. But I want everybody to start thinking about what are they doing when they interact with the child. Why should a child be spontaneously labeling something? When it's maintained by social reinforcement consequences, we've got to make sure we reinforce that behavior and not punish it. Okay? That's why I say some of these concepts are fairly simple, and when you start talking about it, you read about them in a book. But when you start to think about what actually happens for the child, that's when we run into some problems with that. Okay? Anyhow, let's move on. One of the things I would like to talk with you about is assessment. Because everybody says, well, gee whiz, we've got to teach these kids all these skills, but where are we going to start? Okay? Because there's a lot of skills that these children don't have compared to typically developing children. And I'm going to be showing you that graphically in just a few moments. But that's really, really important to understand. Where we start is absolutely critical, because we can have all the best intentions. If we're not working on the right skills in the right manner, we could get the child not wanting to participate with us at all, and maybe holding back and preventing them from actually acquiring many of the skills that they really need to learn. So when we do an assessment, our job is to identify their existing language skills. We want to find out what they can do and what they can't do. And then we want to figure out where we're going to start teaching them, because that's really critical, that we start at the right spot. When it comes to the assessment issues, there's several that are very, very critical here. One is, we want to take a look at the specific verbal operants, the ones I just told you about. Can they ask for things? Can they name things? Can they repeat back these words that we're saying or these phrases that we're using? Can they talk about things in their absence? We need to know what their skill levels are, because all of the kids come to us with different levels of skills in each of those areas. We also want to use something that's going to help us kind of make a comparison from where they are now and where they're going to be later on after we've worked with them. So we want a criterion referenced assessment. If we wanted a standardized type of an assessment, we could do that too. We could find out that they're at the 12-month level or at the 15-month level, but that really doesn't tell us about what their skills are that we're trying to teach. It just says in this general area, this is the, you know, their level of functioning. We need to know specifically what they're doing. That's why I like to use a criterion reference assessment. I'm not so much worried about the age norms, because that doesn't really help me. But I need to know what skills they have, what skills don't they have. That's why I use criterion reference assessment. I also need to figure out what it takes to motivate this kid to respond for me. You know, what do I have to do to get him to participate? Some kids are fairly straightforward and easy. They'll go along with you because you start, you know, getting all excited and making it all fun. And others, it's like, oh, I see work coming and I don't want to be anywhere near you. Okay? They can smell work coming as you walk through the door and they get away from you. Okay? We don't want that. Okay? So we need to figure out what it takes to get this child to participate in these learning activities with us. And we also have to figure out what kind of prompts we may need to use with them, and what types of reinforcers we may need to use, and how often we may need to use them in order to develop their skills in the area of language. Now, there's two verbal behavior assessments that I use. One is the behavioral language assessment form, which is in this book that I co-authored called Teaching Language to Children with Autism or Other Developmental Disabilities. And if you turn in here, go to page 36, you'll find a nice form that you can use to actually measure. It's a very simple, straightforward form that you can fill out if you know the child, probably in about 15 minutes, and it'll guide you through in terms of where you might start language intervention with the child. This is a very easy way to get started. The concept behind it was, if you take a look, you assess in these general areas, and then you follow the interpretation in the next chapter, it'll actually lead you to where you start teaching in the book. So it kind of helps people dial into the right chapters to start teaching skills for the children. There's a second assessment which is much more involved. It's called the Assessment of Basic Language and Learning Skills Revised, the ABLES-R. It's revised 2 years ago. And this is much more extensive. I'll be talking with you about that in a moment or so. This is an example of a behavioral language assessment form, the first one I was talking about in the book, Teaching Language to Children with Autism. It's a very quick way to go through it. So it'll ask some questions about 12 different areas. First one is cooperation with adults. How easy is it to work with the child? And then it has 5 different levels. The first level being the child's always uncooperative, They don't go along with you. They avoid work. They engage in negative behavior to get you to terminate the interaction with you. That's one level. Second level was we'll do one brief and easy response for a powerful reinforcer. So let's just say that I've got these organically grown raisins that they really, really love. And I say, oh, can you give me five? They'll give me five to get that organically grown raisin, okay? So that would be an example of the second level. The third level is we'll give five responses without disruptive behavior, again, assuming that we're continuing to give them reinforcers like the raisins that we were using. The fourth level is we'll work for 5 minutes without disruptive behavior, again, assuming that they're getting a fairly constant flow of reinforcers, actual reinforcers for participating with us. And the fifth level is we'll work well for 10 minutes at a table without disruptive behavior, again, assuming that there's a consistent rate of reinforcement being provided to them. The reason that at a table is put in there is because a number of years ago, a lot of the training, the traditional type of ABA training, was done at the table. This is what a lot of people have seen in the past, where you sit down and you do 10 or 20 trials in a row of a certain type of task, and then you go on from there. The problem is that a lot of times these kids had not enjoyed working at the table very much, okay? So escape and avoidance behaviors were often demonstrated. They'd act up just to get away to stop the sessions, okay? So that's why working at a table for 10 minutes was put in there. Then when it comes to the second skill level, it's the requesting or the manding. How does the child let his needs and wants be known? One, cannot ask for reinforcers or engages in negative behavior. Two, pulls people, points, or stands by reinforcing items. This is what we call communicative intent in speech and language pathology terms. They kind of let you know what they want, but they can't specifically ask for it. They don't have the skills, the independent skills, to ask for those specific items or activities. The third level is uses 1 to 5 words, signs, or pictures to ask for reinforcers. Now they can specifically ask for things, but only a limited amount of them. The fourth level is uses 5 to 10 words, signs, or pictures to ask for items. And the fifth level is frequently requests using 10 or more words, signs, or pictures. So again, now you've got somebody who's using a variety of different ways of asking for different things, okay? So it's very simple like this. I could go into motor imitation, but I'm not. I'm just gonna move on to the next level here. This is what the behavioral language assessment form looks like when it's filled out. This particular profile, all these bottom ones here, essentially represent the child's not doing very much in those areas. Cooperation, requests, motor imitation, vocal play, vocal imitation, matching, receptive language skills, labeling, receptive by function, feature, or class, which we'll talk about a little bit later today, intraverbal, letters and numbers, and social interaction. And what you see from this profile of this little girl is that she would give one response for a powerful reinforcer, okay? She would kind of let you know what she wanted some of the times, but couldn't specifically ask for things. She would babble a little bit. She could do some simple matching. She did respond a little bit receptively and a little bit socially, but that's about it. So we're the very basic level of learner, okay? Now the ABLES R, the Assessment Basic Language and Learning Skills Revised, is a criterion referenced assessment that has 544 items from 25 different areas that we've tracked the children on. We're actually doing it online as well right now. We've got an online program that does it, and I've got some normative data that I'll be sharing with you today, some of that. It serves as a basis for a curriculum. In other words, it lays out enough skills for you to take a look at what they're doing and not doing, and because they're arranged in a somewhat developmental sequence, a pretty close developmental sequence from the easiest to more complex, it kind of leads you through the teaching as to what might be an appropriate type of target for the child to work on next. And last but not least, probably one of the more powerful aspects of the ABLES-R is that it provides you with skills tracking grids. You can actually look and actually see where the child's developing skills and which repertoire and which skills. You can actually see it right in front of you. I'm going to show you what that looks like. This is the grids from page 1 of the ABLES-R. And for instance, in receptive language, there are 57 items. For motor imitation, there's 27 items. I'm going to read across. Cooperation, reinforcer, effectiveness, visual performance skills like puzzles, Piagetti and seriation tasks, putting from smallest to largest, and so forth. Receptive language, motor imitation, vocal imitation, requesting, labeling, intraverbals, and spontaneous vocalizations. So if you look at motor imitation, there's 27 items. You look at receptive language, there's 57 items. Each of these lines going across represents a different item, and the amount filled in represent the amount of that skill as measured by the criterion in the ABLES-R. And it looks like this. If you were to open up the protocol, you'd see that, for instance, it'd say, G2, labels common objects, and it's got a place for scoring. Scores of 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4, the initial scoring, and then your updates. And the question says, if you ask, what is that with a common item present? So if you hold up something for a time, say, what is it? Would they be able to tell you, cup? That's what we're measuring under this particular scale. This is an expressive label. It's not whether or not if I say, oh, can you touch the cup? That's an entirely different skill that's measured under the receptive section, okay? So this is labeling. And if they could label 5 items, they'd get a score of 1. If they could label 4 or less, they'd get a score of 0. If they could label at least 10 items, they'd get a score of 2. If they could label 50 items, they'd get a score of 3. If they could label 100 items, including novel examples, so let's say they've never seen this cup before, but you say, what is it? They go, cup. Okay, 100 items and can label novel ones, they would get a score of 4. Okay, and so that's what we do. We keep track of these things. We measure, what are the skills? This is a different little girl, similar types of skills to the one I just showed you. This is a girl that I started working with. This is on the original version of the ABLES. It came out in 1998, okay? But we've got a nice little demonstration here as to how it progresses over time. I started working with her when she was 2 years, 2 months of age, okay? And when you start to look at her skills, like her requesting skills, it says sometimes she would kind of let you know what you want by going over by something. Couldn't ask for it. She couldn't motorically imitate nor vocally imitate. It took quite a bit to get her to do stuff for us, okay? Required a lot of powerful reinforcers, and she wasn't doing puzzles or those kind of things. This is her when she was 3 years of age, and you could see now that her motor imitation skills had improved because we worked directly on that. The mother worked in teaching these skills. Also worked on the vocal imitation skills. We taught her to request using some sign language. She was able to use that sign language to start labeling some items. She was also using her vocalizations and her labels to be able to start filling some words from some simple songs and things like that, okay? And she was more cooperative. She was now doing some form boxes and single inset puzzles, as well as some matching to sample tests. So we could now measure that. She was also now engaging in more spontaneous vocalizations under different types of conditions. This is her when she was 4.5 years of age. So now you can see that her receptive language skills were improving, her visual performance skills were improving, her cooperation, her working with us was improving. Motor imitation continued to improve, as did her vocal imitation. Now, not only was she requesting, but she was requesting things spontaneously. She was now starting to expressively label some items and was doing it spontaneously. And she was starting to talk about more items. But this kind of then leads us through where we need to do our work. Obviously, when you look at a situation like this, you say, well, she still needs to work on her vocal imitation skills. She needs to be able to ask for other things using pronouns, prepositions, adjectives. She needs to ask for things using like the where, the when, the how, the why, the who type of questions. Those still needed to be developed. And she needed to continue working on some basic concepts. These are basic concepts here that I'm talking about, like adjectives, pronouns, prepositions. She still needs to work on some of those. And multiple component discriminations, like the big brown ball. Can she pick that out from a small brown ball, so forth. And here she was when she was 6.5. She had pretty much filled in the grids, and this is when she went off into kindergarten. I want to go back to that Solos and Gropner article that I talked about from 2005. Glenn Solos, in his article, actually talked about a concept that I've been kind of doing for many, many years now. It turns out about 12, 13 years. And that is, you don't necessarily have to worry so much about the age of the child going into kindergarten. Now, certainly if they're 12 and you're trying to get them into kindergarten, everybody's going to have their eyebrows up. That's not going to work, right? However, there's a great tendency to try to get kids included in regular education kindergartens very, very early when they don't have the skills to participate as a regular education student. Now, are they going to learn some things? Absolutely. However, are they going to learn as those other kids are learning? Maybe not. And that's where with this little girl, when she was 4.5, she could have gone into a kindergarten type of program if we wanted her to. I suggested she not go in. We waited another couple of years till she was 6.5. Yeah, she was a little bit older than her peers, perhaps, but then again, there's a lot of times where parents will hold their kids back anyhow. There's, in some of the areas, you know, parents will hold their boys back so that they'll be a little bit older when they're playing sports, so when they're in high school, that they're better in sports than their other peers, you know, who are freshmen and sophomores, because they're bigger, they're more mature. So those things happen anyhow. Some kids get held back because they don't do so well at early ages anyhow. So holding them back a little bit may not necessarily be a bad thing. I think we still need to do a lot of research, though, to find out where and when we make these discriminations, but I just assume if I want this child to be a regular education student and learning as a regular education student, that we perhaps hold back until we have the child being able to actually participate with the skills that a child has as a regular education student typically. Now, I show this chart as a way of getting you to start thinking about the tasks we're going to pick for children. Certainly, if we go back here and we look here and we say, well, gee whiz, we got all these skills to teach. Well, rather than trying to teach all these hard skills up here, maybe we ought to start teaching some of these little easier skills to teach down here, just conceptually, okay? But what happens is, a lot of times when you start looking at children, these are skills on this axis here, and this is age. So as kids get older, typically developing kids get more skills. All skills are not equal, but let's just take this as a hypothetical example, okay? Notion is, as kids get older, typical kids, they develop more skills. We know by definition that children with autism spectrum disorder are delayed because they don't have the same communication skills. Now, might they have the ability to learn all these things? Yes, they might. But they're delayed in their communication skills, their social interaction skills, so they're behind developmentally. They are delayed. And we know that if we don't do anything differently, what's going to happen is this gap between the typically developing child and the delayed child is going to get larger as they get older. So what we're trying to do with our intervention is trying to see if we can get this line to increase so that we get their rate of acquisition improving, hopefully that they can get caught up. Again, not all will, but even if we get this rate of acquisition improved over here, the child's going to walk away from school experience when they turn 22 with many more skills than they would have otherwise. The problem is that when people start to pick skills for children, they'll say, well, gee whiz, child's here, so we want to get them to work on these skills that they're going to need when they're four, right? Because these are what the other four-year-olds are doing. What people forget is that the children, when they were three, had a lot of skills that this child doesn't have right now. Yes, these children are working on this. We want to get them ready for that. But we got to teach them all the skills that these other kids already have learned. And that's where we got to put our focus. Because a lot of times, people will work on skills such as colors. That's one of the obvious things. Well, we want to get them ready for school, so you need to know their colors, their shapes, their numbers, their letters. Well, quite frankly, knowing shapes and colors are not that big of an issue when you don't even know what the items are. Like, if you don't know that this is a cup, who cares what color it is? It's probably more important to know it's a cup, okay? And you can ask for a cup. You can say it's a cup. You can pick up the cup when somebody tells you to. You can talk about things and say, well, what do you do with a cup? You drink from a cup or you pour things in a cup. That's more important than being able to say, it's white. That's not so important. But I've seen too many times where people have these kids working on shapes. How often do you really use shapes in your life? I mean, think about it. If you don't even know what a shirt is, your backpack is, okay, you don't know what a plate is or a spoon is, you don't know what your bed is or your pillow is, but yet you got these kids working on triangle, okay, or octagon. You know, it's like, give me a break. Why do they need to know that right now? There's more important things to work on. I've seen too many times where children are working on two colors discrimination, red versus blue, but they don't even know that it's a cup or it's a shoe. So what difference does it make what color it is? And people say, well, you know, we worked on it for 8 months. Every day we had two sessions a day for 20 minutes at a time, and we worked on red and blue, and we finally got red and blue. They only have 30 words that they know the labels of items for. What if they had taken those 20 minutes a day, two times a day, the last 8 months, and just taught them the names of common items like their bed, their pillow, their sink, things like that, things that they interact with, the bathtub, the toilet. So if they'd know that, they would probably have a much greater vocabulary and more useful vocabulary than knowing something's red or blue, okay? So I just want you to think about that. Abstractions are hard to teach. They're not easy to teach. If they happen to get the colors, things that have colors, great. But if they don't, you don't want to keep working on these high-level skills and frustrating the child. A lot of times I've been called in on cases simply because what happened was people were working on tasks that were too difficult for the child to learn right now. They didn't have the prerequisite skill. It wasn't a very useful skill. Kid engages in aggressive or disruptive type of behavior to make it stop. What's the problem? The problem is not the kid's behavior. The problem is inappropriate teaching activities being worked on. So that's why I show this. We need to make sure when we teach, we're teaching at the level the child is capable of learning at, and it's appropriate for the child. I showed you the other graph. Now, I'm going to show you what a typical four-year-old child's ABLEs are looks like. It's almost entirely filled out. I'm collecting normative data. I've got students at the University of Nevada, Reno, helping me collect and analyze some of the data, because we've just got a lot of kids coming. We've got about 90 kids that we're actually tracking right now every 3 months, from some as early as 6 months, 9 months, 12 months, and so on. And what we're finding is this is not atypical. This is a typical four-year-old child. This child, this particular child, has already been tested to find out that he's in the normal range of development. So all of these skills that are measured here, that may be very, very difficult for us to teach some of the children with autism spectrum disorder, these are skills that are readily picked up and used by children by the time they're about 4 years of age, many children. There's still some skills and there's some individual variation. Some kids will pick up some of these skills a little bit later in life, some will pick it up even a little bit earlier. But I just want to share with you, the skills that are measured here are pretty much what a typically developing child will have by the time they're in kindergarten, with the exception of perhaps some of the academic skills, okay? This is what a typical four-year-old male looks like, okay? I want to address a couple of questions that came up over the break, because that's always an important time to deal with some of the issues that people are having. One person asked me about table time, because they were asking, you know, is now the recommendation to do more in the natural environment as opposed to table time. I got to tell you, it's got to be a combination of both. I've written about this before. I think it's very, very important. You got to have some work being done at the table. There's a lot of good tasks that can be run at tables. You can teach very, very efficiently, and you can get a lot of trials in very quickly. That has its advantage, but there's also advantages to teaching things in the natural environment, or making sure those skills are being used in the natural environment also. It's not just at the table. It's really a combination of things. Also, with regard to inclusion, some of my comments were that of, you know, you want to kind of make sure that if you want the child to learn as a regular education student, they have to have the skills as a regular education student. However, children can be included in regular education type of environments, but not have all the skills, but they have more appropriate models than they would have in a special education type of a classroom, and that may be beneficial. The only word of caution that I give people on that is, it works very well oftentimes at a very early age, when you're looking at kindergarten and first grade. But if the child is not actively working on developing their ability to talk about things in their absence, the introverbals, when they start getting the second, third, and fourth grade, you'll soon start to see problems arising because the child just doesn't understand what's going on. They can't talk about things in their absence. So you start talking about, you know, who settled a certain country or certain parts of a country and where they came from and why they were trading and what the problems were and, you know, so forth. You get into some real problems if they can't talk about things in their absence. Start talking about science type projects, you know, things like that, predictability about what may happen, but they can't even talk about, you know, the weather and changes in the weather. Then you're going to soon find that they're not going to be able to participate at the same level. They still may be getting some things out of it. But my caution to people is always, take a look at your educational environment when you're making your comparison, saying, well, this is better than that, and say for what reasons, and what other things still need to be worked on outside of that environment. Because a lot of times it's not just this or that, it's this and maybe some other combination of teaching skills to make sure that the child is working on developing those skills that they may not adequately be being addressed in the regular education environment. Nobody stops and talks and teaches specific introverbal types of skills. They kind of, it goes too fast. If that's the case, then you may need to do some other training outside of that environment to keep the language skills so that the child continues to do well. So those are just some comments from the break, okay? But where we left off had to do with we're getting into the motivation. And I said, why should anybody do something for me? And then again, it's not because I'm bigger than they are, or I'm smarter than they are, I've got more degrees than they are. Kids don't care about that. What they care about is the immediate payoff or what's happening for them when they participate with us. And by the way, they do get to be as big as us, and sometimes even bigger than we do. Okay, so if we're relying on the fact that we're bigger than they are, we can make them do something that's not gonna do very well when the kids get a little bit older and we can't make them do it anymore. So we have to get them to cooperate, go along with us because they want to, because it pays off for them. And so how we do that is we have to make sure when we're working on developing a child's early participation skills, we need to make sure that they're successful, that it's easy for them to be successful, to get lots of actual reinforcement for participating with us. That's our key issue that we're dealing with, okay? And it's a lot easier sounding than it is oftentimes when you start working with a child who's uncooperative. So one of the things I always tell people, make sure you're reinforcing the kids for going along with you. That's absolutely has to be number one kind of rule for you. Whenever you're working with a child, got to make sure it pays off for them to do what you want them to do all the time. How do we develop this cooperation? Number one, we start by pairing ourselves with reinforcement. We need to make sure that good things happen when kids work with us. When I first started working with children back in 1972, I walked into a classroom and I'd never worked with children before. I'd worked with psychotic adult males at the institution, and I'd run rats and pigeons in the lab, and I was really good as a behavior analyst. I could get those rats to press the levers that all the other undergraduate students were saying, you know, they got the rat that was delayed. They used another word for it, but I got the stupid rat, right? And then I'd show them that they could get that stupid rat to actually press the lever if they knew what they were doing, right? And so it was one of those things where I realized I was good at it, but I'd never worked with children. But when I walked into the classroom, I asked the teacher, I said, well, what do you want me to do? She said, well, here's your two students. It was Jenny and Rhonda. They were lying on the floor because both of them had cerebral palsy. They were both very much developmentally delayed. And I said, well, what would you like me to do with them? And she said, well, establish yourself as a conditioned reinforcer. And I knew right away what she meant and said, oh, okay. And I went off to work. What that means is get them to like you. Your reaction should serve as a conditioned reinforcer. In other words, pair yourself with the delivery of other reinforcers. Right now, when I walk into a room with children, I'm a neutral stimulus. They don't know that good things happen with me or not. What I have to do is show them that when I'm present, good things happen, okay? And so they want me around. They want to get interactions with me because it serves as a reinforcer for their behavior. So I've got to develop my relationship with other reinforcers. I got to establish myself as a conditioned reinforcer. They need to like me, okay? Now, think back to our example about the child looking out the window and saying, doggy. Well, what if they don't like you? Okay? Why should they tell you that they see a doggy? Because now you're going to come over and interact with them. That's a bad thing, right? So you want the kids to like you, and that's part of establishing yourself as a conditioner. So in English, we say, get them to like you, enjoy you. What you do can serve as a reinforcer for their behavior. Part of what we have to do there is make sure that we start with easy tasks and keep these kids successful. Because there's nothing worse than trying to work with somebody and all of a sudden you can't do it, you can't do it, you can't do it, you're not being successful. I just don't want to be here anymore. Escape and avoidance behavior often occurs. So we have to make sure that what we're doing is keeping these kids successful. And there's a lot of things we can do about that. We've learned, you look at the research, it'll tell you. Kids will often stay on task and keep performing better for you if you intersperse easier with more difficult tasks. Don't just give them all the difficult tasks. If I said to you, hey, we're going to do some differential calculus problems or factor polynomials, a lot of you say, well, you know, I think I got to go home. You know, I think I left my iron on, or, you know, my babysitter probably needs a break right about now. You'll figure out all different kinds of ways of getting out of it. But if I said, hey, we're going to do some math, you go, how many fingers am I holding up? Good, two, that's right. And how many fingers there? How many fingers all together? Three. Oh, excellent. See, now we're doing math. Keep you successful. We can still build into more difficult types of problems. But if everything's difficult, pretty soon you're going to want to get away from it. So we keep mixing the flow, easy with more difficult ones, mastered with acquisition tasks. Okay, we also know about how to take our schedules of reinforcement. When we're working on more difficult tasks, we need to pour on more reinforcement for responding. When it's easier tasks, we might be able to thin it out a little bit, not give as much for those. So we have to be skillful in that, okay? But that's how we develop cooperation. We start by pairing ourselves with reinforcement, and we reinforce them for going along with us. Now, this video that I want to show you is going to be addressing one of the verbal operants we call the echoic, or vocal imitation skills. I want you just to watch and listen to this, because this little girl came to us with a wonderful echoic repertoire. She could vocally imitate just about anything. And her prosody skills, her ability to match the pitch and intonation are absolutely phenomenal. Let me just let it run by itself here. Here we go.
Horse. Look at Zach. There's Zach. Yeah, there's Zach. Oh, Jeffrey.
Jeffrey,
right. Anthony.
Anthony.
All right. Oh, Lucy. There's Gwen. Right there, yeah. And there's Jack.
Yeah.
Look at Anthony.